of fun to be here because it's South by Southwest. It's music and film and interactive and all of these things.
I'm excited to see my movie for the first time with a crowd.
Very excited.
Baby Driver.
The nice part about what our movie does is combines film and music.
Every film has music in it.
But for us, it's a real component to it.
Like, there's no way to describe it, and that just says it's a unique, special movie and that you've not seen something like this before.
It's a good mix, and I think that's what South by is all about.
That it's a music and a film festival is fantastic. I'm excited for people to see it tonight.
It's a big theater too. There's like 1,200 seats, so I think it's going to be great energy.
I feel like the audience here will kind of really appreciate it on a deeper level.
How kick-ass was that? I mean, you know, Edgar Wright always blows me away. I remember in 2004 here in Austin, he brought his first film, Shaun of the Dead, and I just was floored by his talent. I roped him into doing something for us for Grindhouse. I'm just gonna start my genuflecting right now. Ladies and gentlemen, Edgar Wright.
Thank you.
Kick ass, bro.
That's so good. Thank you.
I'm gonna bring out the cast as well.
Yes, let's bring out the cast. So in the part of Darling, Miss Eiza González. And in the part of Buddy, Mr. John Hamm. And last but by no means least, the man himself, his baby, Ansel Elgort.
I know you've been working on this movie for a while, but I was not expecting that level of intensity. I mean, you always, you're just the greatest hits, great mixtape. I mean, you brought the music and the love story. In fact, all your movies are a love story, even, you know, Shaun of the Dead. But the intensity in this was just fantastic. How much, I know you were inspired by one of my favorite movies, you know, Walter Hill's The Driver. He'd be freaking proud of how intense you made this. What were you going for?
Walter Hill does a cameo right at the end. He plays the voice of the courtroom interpreter. So Walter Hill's voice is in the movie, which is very sweet. I mean, it's something I always wanted to do. Like, you know, it's sort of, like I said, a dream movie of making it like an action movie driven by music. But I always wanted it to kind of be something where it is sort of like the old Warner Brothers gangster films. It is like a cautionary tale in terms of like the first chase that you see is the dream. That's the sort of dream chase. And if people have had fantasies about being in a high-speed pursuit, that opening scene is how you hope it would go. And then with each successive action scene, the stakes get higher and the consequences more obvious to Ansel's character and the human collateral. And then it's about him escaping from his job. So I wanted it to be a film where the sort of the intensity keeps going up as it goes on, you know?
And one of the things that really takes it over the top, of course, is the music. When did you, how much of this was pre-thought music chosen while you were writing? This is the first movie you've written by yourself. And then how much was in post did you find? Or was it all from beginning? Did you have the music ahead of time?
It was all written into the script. Like I said, some of the tracks, like, I sort of had the germ of the idea so long ago when I heard Bell Bottoms, that first track. And then as I started actually writing it, I sort of had ideas for set pieces. Like, so I sort of knew, like, and it just through listening to my record collection is I sort of visualized scenes. And so, but then when I wrote the rest of the script, I wouldn't write the scene until I found the right track.
Wow, that's great.
And so I would just, you know, like, I'd get the right length track and the right tempo. So it was kind of scoring it from the off. And the songs never really changed. I think only one song changed afterwards. We were very lucky that we had the film got pushed by 6 months, and because of that, an amazing clearance person, Kirsten Lane, in the UK. By the time we started filming, we cleared every track.
Wow.
You know, and
That's really difficult, by the way.
Yeah.
It's super difficult to clear them at all, much less before a movie even starts.
Yeah, I think, you know, it was good that a lot of people wanted to be on board with the project and maybe like the use of music in my other films. But, you know, so then we could start rehearsing. I mean, the process of that with the music is it's written into the script. Then I did storyboards. Then I cut the storyboards to the music and saw how that worked. And that sometimes worked perfectly as I imagined it. And sometimes there'd be little changes. Like, in fact, Bill Pope is in the audience. There's one bit where the second chase, give a round of applause for my cinematographer.
Cinematographer, Bill Pope.
He's far too modest. There was one chase, the second one actually, which had the Damned soundtrack, that cut together the animatic, and Bill very correctly pointed out, he said, your action is too long for the song, because the song is only 2.5 minutes long, and I was watching it, and it was like, so it was little interesting happy accidents like that, so I was like, ah, I don't want to change the song, and I don't want to like have a second song. So then on the last day of the shoot, after we'd cut it together and Bill was entirely correct, I did a shot of Ansel rewinding the track so that he could start the last chorus again. So it was like, so it was all like planned out, and then there would be those nice happy accidents like that. But we had the tracks to rehearse to, both with the stunt team and this great choreographer called Ryan Hefferton, who you might know his work from the Chandelier video and the Sia Chandelier video and Spike Jonze's Kenzo short that was online recently. He was the choreographer on the movie. So we, you know, like, and I mean, you can ask these guys, but we played all the tracks in on set.
Yeah, so how did you do that? Did you have it in an ear, or was it on just playing on the set? Because it was so timed to the music. Like, you did a musical. It was so timed out. How did you do that?
Yeah. Well, I was lucky because I always had earbuds in. So I could just plug them right into something that a guy I play back would play it. But they had to have little uncomfortable earwigs in. So, whenever the music was playing, the music that the audience, that you guys heard, I was hearing too. So I could, you know, either if I was just doing the little movements to it or if it wasn't even something that I had choreography to, just so I could feel it. Why not, you know? It was always so helpful. It was the first time I've ever had that, been able to do that in a movie. It was really cool.
There was just different forms of that as well, because like sometimes he'd have it in his ears, sometimes they could hear it, sometimes we'd play it out loud. And then on some occasions, like when we're doing the gunfight scene, as you might imagine, automatic weapons cancel out any playback. So then we had to do a thing with that tequila scene and also the hocus pocus scene and the final scene when there's shooting in time, is these actors sort of had to learn their gunshots to the guitar parts of the song. I mean, yeah. John Hamm is very good at it. But it was an amazing thing to do with not just these actors, obviously, who have, some of whom have a background that do choreography and dance, but to do that with, dude-ish stuntmen is kind of funny, where you've got a choreographer saying, okay, and then you come in and go, bam, 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 bam. And they do
which
it.
Which we all did as little kids, but doing it with an actual automatic weapon when there are squibs and things that are depending on and you doing it on the right timing is a whole different thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's awesome. That's the greatest musical you could do. Action musical. How did you choose John?
I was very lucky. I mean, this amazing cast, none of whom I've worked with before, and Eiza Robert, in fact, recommended to me. I thank Robert for Aza's casting.
That was a stroke of genius casting Aza. Right? It's always difficult when someone calls you up and they say, who would you recommend to play the lead? I'm looking for, and I say, I'm working with this girl, Aza. And it's like, she better do a good job because I just recommended you to my friend.
Yeah,
and you
no
rocked
pressure
it.
At all.
You kicked ass. Thank you.
Ansel, I met, we auditioned, and Ansel was like, I saw several young actors, but he quickly became the favorite. And I think, maybe out of a mutual love of music. John is the only member of the cast, apart from Paul Williams, that I knew. John is the only member of the cast I knew before the movie, and the only member of the cast I wrote the part for him. So it was nice having known John for 8 years, to actually say, oh, I've written something for you. And I did a read-through of the script in 2012. When we had the first draft, and John was the only person at that table who's still in the movie. He did it!
like the character, he never goes away, he's relentless. What was your preparation like? I mean, I never seen you like that before. Is it freaking awesome?
Go for it.
To be mean and awful and vindictive. Just being an actor in L.A. will do that to you pretty well. just for 20-some-odd years. No, it was, you know, Edgar writes, obviously, and makes these things so incredibly cinematic that there's not a whole lot of other work to do. This was a pretty fully realized thing, as Edgar mentioned, when I participated in the read-through back 6 years ago, however many years ago it was. It was fully realized. I mean, in his head, it was fully realized. And we'd show up on set, and you'd see the shots lined up with little red X's as we'd go through the day. And right. it's all there. So it was, my job was not to fuck it up, really. and you know, trip and fall, or and you know, do anything that would get anybody hurt, or you know, worse, look terrible on film. So I mean, it's a testament to his talent that it's come out this well.
Yeah, awesome, Edgar Wright. I'm always blown away by how, I don't know how you do it. I mean, you guys worked with other directors. What was it like working with Edgar in particular? Because he is just so unique. What did you find different about him?
Wow, I mean, it's hard to explain the experience of working with people. And like you, or Edgar in general, it really is. You are, when we got the script, I mean, this basically
Robert has better arms than I do.
This basically explains it all. You can see how Edgar is a well-prepared director. He has a vision. And when we got the script, we got a playlist at the same time. And I remember getting the email. I was like, the fuck is this? And I was like, okay. It's like, you got to play it at the same time. And I remember, like, I played it. And you saw that opening sequence when Ansel goes for the coffee. And I read, yeah, yeah, yeah. And right where I read it, it was like, yeah, yeah, yeah. I was like, holy shit! It's like, this is insane. And from there on, it was just the whole movie itself. And that shows you, like, and I keep repeating this, I don't feel like it's safe to say Edgar is unbelievably talented. And he writes every character for a specific reason. And I feel like, as a public, you see each character flee. Everyone just added to the script. There wasn't like random characters just to fill in the blanks. And that's when you know you're working with an amazing, brilliant man. And the prep and the whole thing, we walked into set and we already knew what we had to do because he already had an idea. He set it on the table 2 months. We prepped, we were there, and we did it.
That's awesome. If anybody has a question, come up to this microphone. What was it like working with Jamie Foxx and Kevin Spacey? I mean, you get great performances out of everybody, but they were fantastic, too.
Anytime Jamie and Kevin were in the same shot, I would whisper to Bill Pope, double Oscar shot, double Oscar shot. I mean, they're amazing. The greatest thing, I mean, this is such a great ensemble, but it's amazing with, like, Kevin and Jamie, who are, like, massive stars, is how deferential they were to each other. And one of my favorite memories is, like, sometimes when Kevin was doing a single and maybe Jamie wasn't even in it, he would sometimes, like, just sit off camera and watch, you know, like, so I found that, like, they were both incredible to work with and fun to have around. The other thing Jamie Foxx always used to say is whenever he'd sometimes be by the monitor with me, he did this about 3 times during the shoot, and if it was a single of John, Jamie Foxx would stand at the monitor and go, he handsome. And he would say it and walk off, which is my favorite Jamie moment.
We have a question right here.
I had the awesome opportunity to work with Ansel on Men, Women, Children as a stand-in, and he always had his earbuds in, like, nonstop. I have one question. Was it like that on this set as well in the off time? And also, did you feel like you were, like, already half the role by the time you saw what it was because you're already musically inclined as a musician?
Hey, man. What's your name?
Matt.
Hey, Matt. Well, I want to answer your question, but first of all, I just want to say, because I feel like I need to say this, this is the first time we've seen it with an audience, and I'm so happy. It feels so cool to be with you guys all here. Woo!
Greatest Austin audience ever.
So cool. And Matt, I think, you know, I do music, and music's a big part of my life, and I actually got into acting because of singing and dancing when I was younger. Musical theater was like my dream. And I think it's because of that Edgar and I, when we first met, really hit it off. We talked about music. He told, you know, I had read the script and I knew what a music movie this was. And I said, you know, I love the music in the script. So cool. Not all of it I know. I'm looking forward to knowing more. And we talked a lot about music. At the time, I was DJing a lot and producing club music. And he thought that was really cool. And yeah, we just really hit it off. I think I'm just lucky. Everything happens for a reason. I was so into music, and that led me to this role. And
yeah, I think it's also because Ansel plays instruments and stuff. Like, that's also a big part. And one of my favorite scenes of Ansel in the movie is when Kevin Spacey's doing that briefing and he's playing on the table to Dave Brubeck. And it's just like, that almost is like my favorite image of Baby in the whole movie. And the fact that, like, Ansel, who's, you know, was 21 turning 22 on set, is playing along to 50s Dave Brubeck, I find utterly charming.
I just right want here. To say what an absolutely fresh film it was. It was so
fresh. Oh, thank
fresh.
You.
Thank you.
Right here, a question.
Yeah, hi, good evening. So much to unpack from you guys standing in order from height, Thomas the shortest,
John
being my fellow Missourian, Ansel, you saying you want to, you know, follow your dreams and become, you know, musical theater's your thing. Follow your dreams, man. I think you really got, you got a future ahead of you.
Thanks, dude.
My name's Ozzy. I live here in Austin, Texas, and I go to school at the Austin Community College. Go Riverbats! And I'm in school to become an ASL interpreter. So when you were saying that all the characters that Edgar had written into the film, there's no dead weight. So I instantly, when I saw your deaf character on screen, thought that was amazing, way to use someone who is deaf in a positive light in a really cool way. Just, you know, tell us more about that, how you got, why you picked that person, how you learned ASL for this. Just, you know, that's cool stuff. Let's hear about it.
Well, that performer, thanks, the guy who plays Joe, is a deaf actor called CJ Jones. And I had written that into the script. It was in the script. And I said to the casting director, let's see some deaf actors of that age range. And I had written it as like 85 years old. And there basically wasn't anybody, and the closest person was CJ. And what was interesting was CJ was the only deaf actor that we saw. And we auditioned him and he was great. And then we saw some other actors. And when you've seen a deaf actor perform so brilliantly as he did, and then you start auditioning actors pretending to be deaf, I just sort of said, stop. I said, we should go back and see that guy again. And then we gave him the part because it was just, he was amazing. I think CJ Jones is fantastic in the movie. He's actually like 20, he's a stand-up. He's a deaf stand-up, CJ Jones. And we all fell in love with him. Ansel, you can probably talk a bit about CJ.
Yeah, he told me also, which is really amazing, he's the first ever deaf African-American actor in a motion picture. So, pretty cool.
Question right here.
How much of the driving was practical, and did you have to use CGI for anything?
There's no CGI car stuff in the movie at all. There's very little like green screen shots in it. It's all real.
All the driving.
That was us flying in that car.
No, I mean it was all like sort of real driving, you know. A lot of other kind of like sort of big studio movies might shoot the chases completely separately and then do all the actor stuff green screen later. And I didn't want to do that, which immediately made the entire thing much more complicated. And my line producer, Adam Merrims, I remember looking at me like, you really want to do this all for real? And, you know, like we did it when it was like sort of, it was a really complicated production thing. Because all of those shots where not just the shots of them driving themselves, but also the shots of the actors driving the car, are all done on real streets. And they're also all done in the daytime as well. You know, a lot of the time, the reasons you see chases at night is because it's easier to close down roads at night. But we're closing down, like, busy streets in Atlanta, and even the Interstate 85, which is the main freeway in Atlanta, and shot on them during the daytime. So it was incredibly difficult, and, you know, Robert is an amazing action director, and I'm sort of people who do great car sequences. I'm always in awe of them. And now having made those sequences, I'm even more in awe of people who do those things because they're as arduous to make as they are fun to watch. Like, so every single one of those shots in the car chase is, you know, a big setup. And, like, you know, doing all of the kind of... Also, I had this thing, like, John will remember this, is that sometimes I would strap myself to the car rather than following the pursuit vehicle because, I mean, you know this, but like sometimes if you're in the command van that's following, the satellite link will go and then you haven't seen anything.
Can't see, can't direct.
Can't see, can't direct, can't talk to the actors. And eventually I said, just strap me onto the car as well. Which is one of those, like, you know, harebrained things that once you've committed to it, you have to do it. And you don't want to
From my point of view, I'm looking at, like, a floppy sunburn Muppet that's just literally trying to hold the monitor, and it's like this. Well, that can't be healthy. He's gonna really pull something.
Every single take would catch me by surprise as well. Every single time they took off, it would always be... And like, so like, I would never, ever be ready for the speed that the car was going to go off. I hit my head on my monitor so many times. And, you know, because you're in front of a bunch of stunt dudes, you're like, you know what? I'm good. I'm fine. Like,
by the way, shout out to our stunt team who did an amazing job.
Did you have a, you know, when you can't communicate that well in car stuff, you have to sometimes use a shorthand. Did you ever use like code words or code directions? So it's two word directions.
I would have a bunch of, one of the trickiest things doing the action sequences is actually, because you know this is that when you're driving, you might be on the freeway and it's like, once you're on that freeway, you've got maybe four takes. But it's not like you've necessarily got anything different to do. It's like, we've only got like three goes on this freeway. Let's get as many takes as possible. And so the hardest thing for me and the actors is just like maintaining that intensity. And like I'm sitting in front of the windscreen and it would be literally like, okay, go, intense, you know, like saying intense. And then me and Ansel would have a couple of code words because also over a walkie-talkie, there's no time for like flowery like direction. You've got to get it down to like words. And the two things that me and Ansel would have as code was one of them was like, because the film's called Baby Driver, but I wanted to look tough, so I would say, man driver.
And then what would he do?
Yeah, exactly. So I would say man driver, and then Ansel would look all tough.
That's good. That's it.
Perfect.
And then the other one, which I love, is like the other one that we get down to is like to sort of what I call the Kubrick shot, which is head down, eyes up. And so I would say to Ansel, I say, Clockwork Orange face.
Had he ever seen Clockwork Orange?
I showed you like, I think I just showed you the still. I literally got like a still of Malcolm McDowell and my friend said, like this. But that is when you're driving, there is no time for like considered articulate dialogue because you're talking on a walkie and it has to get down to two or three words or one word. Because, you know, once you know this, when we're on that freeway, it's like sort of like, you know, we shot on the 85 twice, which if you've been to Atlanta, you know, is the major freeway. But, you know, when the police say you have 6 until 2, they are kicking you off at 2 p.m. That's it. Time out. And so we did that twice, which was a surreal experience being on that freeway, you know, shooting.
Question? Right here.
Hi. First of all, that was fucking awesome. And, so I actually have two questions, if that's okay. Great.
Go for it.
First one for Edgar. So, you know, you sort of do these movies where you have these ordinary characters and they have to become like larger than life action heroes to avoid the sort of like crazy shit they're in. So I'm just wondering what draws you to these stories?
I think I write I think you're sort of living vicariously through the characters. Like sometimes you're writing like the thing that you cannot do. I know now I will never be a great getaway driver, so I sort of like in like writing about it and like learning about it, both from all the gearheads on set and even like I said in the intro, like from ex-cons that I talk to, is like a fascinating thing. So, you know, and I think in a way it's like I said, it's that thing about what the movie is about is the fantasy of the job versus the reality of the crime. And so that's something that was interesting to me because I think everybody has thought about that thing. If you blow a red light and the police car goes whoop, whoop, and you press accelerator, you are in trouble immediately. And lots of people have done that, and lots of people play those video games and stuff. So I thought like this is a way to kind of write a character where you can see everything through his eyes.
I'm a filmmaker, same. Like, I think about that stuff all the time. Like, yeah, I can never do it, but, yeah, but I don't even drive, but.
Another question over here on the right.
Actually, can I just ask my.
Thanks, sir.
Let him have his second one. But go, what is it?
All right, so it's for John. So I'm a big fan of yours on I was on Mad Men, but you did Keeping Up with the Joneses. Yeah.
Thank you.
You did Keeping Up with the Joneses, which is like this big action comedy. Now this one, do you see yourself playing like an action hero?
Yeah, I'm going to be doing that for the rest of my career. Thank you. Yeah. It's just it's the beginning. I'm going to keep doing those. Got a lot of things lined up with some big studios. You know the ones. All the big ones. Doing most of the superheroes. I'm gonna start doing those, and Edgar's gonna direct them all. So it's gonna be great, you guys. So start looking for those to roll out. Start looking for those to roll out.
Yeah. Sure. My question is to Edgar Wright. As far as the writing process is concerned, considering this film requires a lot of like music and heavy coordination, what challenges did you face with the writing process for this film as opposed to the Cornetto trilogy and Scott Pilgrim versus the World?
Well, the other movies that I co-wrote, you know, I co-wrote movies with Simon Pegg and Joe Cornish and Michael Bacall. And because this was something that was like a bit of a departure and also not strictly a comedy, I wanted to write it on my own. But it was also the toughest thing. I think the toughest thing about it is writing solo is you're always looking for a sounding board. So whether it's like my producer or my agent, you know, or like sort of a friend say, oh, will you read these three pages? They're always looking for like somebody to read what you've done that day immediately. I mean, I don't know if you have that, but I find it sort of, I need immediate sort of validation of like, is this working and stuff. So it was definitely it took the longest out of my screenplays to write. And also writing action, you know this, and actually Walter Hill is the king of it. Yeah. Writing action is really tough because it's a strange thing where you are writing words which are eventually going to be visuals. And I remember saying to my friend, exasperated one day, is like, oh, I can see it. I wish I didn't have to write it down. But you do. You have to write action right. And make it seem exciting on the page, which is tough, you know?
Yeah. I guess I didn't think about that until you just said it. Yeah, with your co-writers, you write something, they read it, and they can actually offer back suggestions and, oh, you can change this and that.
Yeah.
Where when you don't have that, you might just get impressions, and then you've got to go figure it all out yourself.
So yeah, it took a lot longer because of that. It was a lonely.
You think you'll write another one again by yourself?
Yeah, I'd like to actually. I enjoyed writing this one. I mean, one of the people actually that was a real help as well was one of the ex bank robbers that I worked with, John. One of the ex bank robbers that I found through our researcher who had like in the 80s and 90s had committed like 30 bank robberies. He'd been inside, done his time. He was out, and he was like writing. He'd written a non-fiction book. His name's Joe Loya, L-O-Y-A. And he sort of became the technical consultant on the movie. So I'd already written the first draft. And I was a bit cagey at first about showing him stuff. So I would just ask him about characters. And I'd say, do you know anybody like this? Or do you ever meet anybody like this? Or are you like this? Or things about the job. And a lot of the sort of specifications of the job, you know, especially things like using commuter cars and family cars instead of like vintage muscle cars and, you know, hot rods in the actual, you know, in the robberies themselves and, you know, all of that specificity. But he is also actually plays the security guard that Jamie Foxx shoots. So he's in the movie as well. So that was great. It was great to kind of have. So he was somebody as well that I ended up using as a sounding board just in terms of like fact checking it.
Yeah, making it realistic. We got a question over here.
Hey guys, that was incredible. Great work. Congrats. Edgar Wright, your films are really fluid and they have a really unique soul and they come together really well. How is the editing process broken down to you a little bit?
Editor, stand up.
One of my two editors is in the house. Paul's matchless, stand up.
Great job.
I've been very lucky. I've worked with like three great editors in my career, and all of them I've worked with, you know, like sort of Paul. I have worked with since Space. Paul was the online editor on the first series, and he was the editor on the second series. And then, Paul's first kind of like feature film. His first feature film that he ever edited was Scott Pilgrim, which he got an ACE award for, which is amazing. But the good thing is because we've worked together for now, like, sort of, I don't know, 17 years, we have a shorthand. He's great with music. Our other editor, John Amos, is also, they make a great team. And it's just like, so there's a shorthand that you get after working together for so long. And with something this ambitious and this dense musically, and the editing is so sort of precise, we actually edited a lot on the set, which I don't usually do and didn't used to like doing. But on this one, it became a must. And then it really helped. Because then you could actually figure out whether something was off or like, this Steadicam shot's got to be the same length as this intro. Is it, you know, like, and I would, you know, after a take, I'd say, Paul, does it fit? And he'd be like, yes. Like, and again, okay, we're moving on. Like, so it's just like sort of, you know, just mutual trust after working together for so many years.
Thank you. I just want to say quickly about like how cool that was. So when I first showed up to rehearsal, Edgar showed me basically the entire film in an animatic, in little sketches. Every single shot that's in the movie was in these animatics. And Paul would sit there with his computer with the animatic, and we'd shoot the scene, and every shot we got, he would replace the animatic with the real shot. And at the end of the scene, the entire scene would be edited, and you can walk over to the computer and watch the scene, which was the most insane thing ever.
Yeah.
It was awesome.
That's awesome. Cool. Thank you. So how long did you draw out the movie before that? Was this like over different versions that you had written that you had collected many boards, or did you take a long pre-production after you got this movie greenlit?
We storyboarded some of the sequences to get the green light from the studio. So we actually just did stuff on our own sort of dime. Actually through working title, we did sort of a bunch of stuff so that we could have a proof of concept. So I think like three of the action sequences have been like boarded out. And then, you know, once we knew it was actually happening and stuff, then it was like there was a team of like three great storyboard artists and my brother as well, who kind of works with me and sort of oversaw it and stuff. So it was you know, like, so I mean, that's just a lot of work, but also, you know, it's, you can't kind of get through a shoot like this without that kind of planning.
Yeah.
It's just having this kind of like sort of the it's not, I'm not the kind of director who kind of finds something on the day. But also, I don't really have time to do that anyway. It's right. Just like sort of like this is the script we want to do. Never have quite enough time. So the only way to do it is like, here's what we're doing, and we're gonna hit it, and we're gonna get all of these shots.
You told me something that was giving me nightmares back here just thinking about it, because I don't think I'd have that stamina. You said you would be shooting a night, pre-planned it, shooting all night, then you'd have to go show up for the second unit, which was shooting the chase stuff in the morning. See what they're doing, go sleep for a few hours, and go back, visit them again before going to set the next night. That is really
hard. It was my lowest ebb on the... there was a point in the middle of the shoot where the middle month, we only had like 1 month of... or 3 weeks of second unit, and so, yeah, it's exactly that. It's me and Bill would be shooting at night. They would be shooting during the day, so I'd wrap at night, go to them for breakfast, talk to Darren, the stunt coordinator, stick around with them for a couple of setups, go home, sleep 6 hours, come back to them, watch what they've been doing that day, and then go back to work at night for like then another like 12 hours. I would not recommend it.
Well, the results are all on the screen, right here.
A few minutes ago, John said that everything was, when he would come in for the day, everything was lined up and he would put X's on it. Can you elaborate on that?
It's just a thing of like sort of just having a visual. I think sometimes also for, you know, there are the main crew who get all the storyboards, and then on a film set, a lot of the crew don't get the storyboards. So if you come in and you got all the storyboards on a page and you literally put magnetic X's on it when it's done, then the people who are not like part of the storyboard sort of don't get their sides. The grips can go, oh, okay, I know what we're doing. Do you know what I mean? Sort of like, it's as simple as that. It's literally just like X-ing out this kind of like shopping list. And obviously, I say that in terms of the prep and the editing stuff, there are like happy accidents that come out of it, both in terms of performance or something with a location or something that doesn't quite work and you have to do something different. So there's a lot of that as well, but that was basically how to get through the schedule.
So you try to keep a binder on you the day of or something with like storyboards and shopping?
Yeah.
And everything?
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to take, I think, wrapping this up. Let's take one more question from the audience. Right there?
Oh, you want to take
one more?
A girl.
You can be the last one.
Hi, I love the film, and I also loved how much you made Lana part of the character of the film. How much of it was, I know right now Atlanta's kind of been using as substituting as other cities for movies, how much of it was important to keep the personality of the city, and was it always your first choice for the film?
I'm glad you asked that, because it was not the first choice. I wrote the script for Los Angeles because I was living in Los Angeles at the time. So, you know, and then what can happen is, obviously happens a lot in movies now, is that films have to go to other cities for better tax breaks. And so then I started exploring the tax break cities. And so I had an interesting like tour where I went to Detroit, Cleveland, New Orleans, and Atlanta. And Detroit was cool, but we did not want to be there in the winter. People say, do not go there in February. Cleveland, same reason. New Orleans, their tax break fell through. And then Atlanta, sort of, I had been there, and I was very aware that it had been shot by a lot of other movies, but usually doubling for something else. And I'm not a big fan of that when it's like, sort of, you know, you get, Atlanta is on screen like New York, like San Francisco, LA, it never quite looks like any of them. So when I went there, I sort of did a bit of research, and I went for a weekend. And I'd been there before, but I went specifically and asked a non-local location manager, say, can we go to all the places that people don't shoot in? And we're going to shoot Atlanta for Atlanta. And then there was one thing that I think you'll probably find this funny, is that our location manager, a guy called Doug Dresser, who's amazing, who actually worked on like films like Jackie Brown, and actually maybe he went with you back in the day.
Yeah.
On From Dusk Till Dawn, right? Yeah, Doug Dresser. So I said to him, like, I was very adamant that like it had to look concrete. Like Atlanta is a very, very leafy city. And usually in Atlanta, they stick you out on this freeway in the country because it's easy. And it's in every car chase movie you see in Atlanta. And it's literally like the Smokey and the Bandit freeway, which is cool. But to me, it looked like as soon as you see like trees, it looks like they already got away. And I said to Doug Dresser, I said, if we don't get the 85 and we don't have the concrete jungle and don't have the built up part of Atlanta, there's no movie. And I sort of said, I used a Burt Reynolds gauge. I said, it has to be more Sharky's Machine and less Smokey and the Bandit. And so Sharky's Machine is a great Burt Reynolds movie shot in Atlanta in the downtown bit. In fact, a lot of the locations we were in. So all the way through the location scout, our thing would be less Smokey, more Sharky. So there you go. But I hope, I mean, as soon as I made the decision to rewrite it for Atlanta, it made me so much more invested in being there. And I asked local people, actually some local writers, a guy called Diallo Riddle, who's an Atlanta writer, I said, like, and he lived in LA as well, so I said, here's my LA script, help me kind of put this in Atlanta, and then I did a lot of research, and hopefully we did Atlanta proud, you know?
Well, this is a wonderful night here with Edgar, tremendous achievement. I can't believe.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I can't believe we have to wait till August for it to come out. So please tell your friends, because it's a fantastic, very original, very kick-ass movie. Congratulations.
Thanks for coming. Thank you.
Thank you, Austin, for being a great audience again.